everyone. Thank you. Welcome to Larnerd, Davis, Leonard, Quinn, Hickey, guys, help me out.
Eva Borgwardt.
Tess, Draushack, Eva Borgwardt, Kwasi, Oppong-Badu, Quincy, Tichenor, Ruby Flatinsky, more. Raul, Albany, Ben, Hogoboom, and Marco. Is about an hour 50. This is a little bit of a content warning, but I'm sure you guys can handle it. And other than that, thank you so much for coming. I love you. This name came something saucing to the world before you sent for. It was good sport in his making, and the poor son must be acknowledged.
Edmund, tell me this noble gentleman.
No, my lord. Remember him hereafter as my honorable friend, Lord Kent.
I must love you and soon to know you better.
I shall study his service.
Been away 9 years, and away he shall again.
The king is coming!
Attend the lords of France and Burgundy, Gloucester.
I shall move.
Give me the map there. No? We have divided and free our kingdom, which is our vast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strength will we unburden crawl towards death. Our son of Cornwall, and you, our no less loving son of Albany, we have this hour a constant will to publish our daughter's several dowers, and future strife may be prevented now. If princes, friends, and Burgundy, great rivals, and our youngest daughter's love have long in our court made their amorous sojourn here to the answer. Now, since we will divest both of rule, interests of territory, cares of state, which of you, shall we say, doth love us most, that we our largest bounty may extend where nature doth with merit challenge? Goneril, our eldest born, speak first.
Nothing.
come of nothing, speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more, no less.
Now, Cordelia, mend your speech a little, lest it may mar your fortune.
Good my lord, you have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honor you. Why have my sisters husbands? If they say they love you all, happy when I shall wed, that lord whose hand must take my place shall carry half my love with him, half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters to love my father all.
Goes thy heart with this?
I could, my lord.
So young and so untender.
So young, my lord, and true.
Let be so thy truth, then be thy doubt. Here I disclaim all my maternal care. Propinquity and robbery of blood, and as a stranger to my heart, me will be from this forever. The barbarous Scythian, or he that makes his generation messes to gorged appetite, shall to my heart be as well neighbor, pitied and relieved as thou, my sometime lover.
My leash.
Peace. Kent, I loved her most, and thought to set my rest by her kind nursery. Hence, and avoid my sight. So be my grave, my peace, as here I give her father's heart from her. Call France, who stirs? Call Burgundy, Cornwall, and Albany. With my two daughters, thou wast digest this third. Let pride, which she calls plainness, marry her. I do invest you jointly with all the preeminence that troops with majesty. Ourselves, by monthly course, with reservation of 100 knights, by you to be sustained, shall our abode make with you by due terms. Only we still retain the name and all the additions to a king. The sway, revenue, execution of the rest, beloved sons be yours, which to confirm this coronet, partly betwixt you.
Royal Lear, whom I have ever honored as my king, loved as my father, as my master called, as my great patron thought on in my prayers.
What was bent and drawn make from the shaft?
Let it fall, rather, though the fork be the region of my heart. Be Kent unmannerly when Lear is mad. What wilt thou do, old man? Thinkest thou that duty shall have dread to speak when power to flattery bows, to plainest honors bound? When majesty stoops to folly, reverse thy doom, and in thy best consideration check this hideous rashness. Answer my life, my judgment. Thy youngest daughter does not love thee least, nor are those empty bodies whose low sounds are of no hollowness.
Out of my sight.
See better, Lear, and let me still remain the true blank of thine eye.
O vassal, miscreant!
Sir, forbid. Do kill thy physician when the fee bestowed upon thy foul disease. Revoke thy doom, Lear, or whilst I can vent clamor from my throat, I'll tell thee thou dost evil.
Hear me, recreant, on thine allegiance here. Thou sought to make us break our vow, which we durst never yet, when strained pride come between our sentence and our powers, nor our nature, nor our place can bear, our potency made good. Take thy reward. 5 days we do allot thee for provision to shield thee from diseases of the world, and on the 6th to turn thy hated back from our kingdom forever. On the 10th day following thy banished trunk be found in our domain, the moment is thy death. Away by Jupiter, this shall not be revoked.
Very well, King, since thus thou wilt appear, freedom is hence, and banishment is here.
Prince of Burgundy, my liege.
My lord of Burgundy, we first address towards you with this great king hath rivaled for our daughter. What in present will you require endowed with her? Cease your quest for love.
Royal Majesty, I crave no more than what your highness offered. Nor will you take the best.
Right, noble Burgundy, when she was dear to us, we did hold her so, but now her price has fallen. Sir, there she stands. If aught within that little seeming substance, with our displeasure, peace, and nothing more, may fitly like her grace, she's there and is yours.
I know no answer.
Will you, with those infirmities she owes, strange with her oath and new adopted to her hate, take her or leave her?
Pardon me, election makes not up on such conditions.
Then leave her, for as I'm a man, I tell you all her worth. My great queen of France, I would not from your love make such a stray as to match you where I hate. Therefore, I beseech you, avert your liking a more worthier way than on a wretch whose known nature is ashamed almost to acknowledge hers.
This is most strange, that she, that even but now is your best object, beyond me to praise, the balm of your age, most best, most dearest, should in this trice of time commit a thing so monstrous to dismantle so many folds of it. Sure, her offense must be of such unnatural degree that monsters in her forebauched affection fall into taint. Which to believe in her must be a fate that reason without miracle could never plant in me.
I yet beseech your majesty, if for I want that glib and oily art to speak and purpose not, since what I well intend, I'll do it before I speak, that you may know it is no vicious blot, no murder or foulness that hath deprived me of your grace and favor. But even for want of that for which I am richer, a still soliciting eye and such a tongue as I am glad I have not, but not to have it hath lost me in your liking.
And that has not been born, has not been seen.
Is it but this? A tardiness in nature that often leaves the history unspoken that it intends to do. My lord of Burgundy, what say you to the lady? Love's not love when it is mingled with the guards that stand aloof from the entire point. Will you have her? She is herself a dowager.
Royal being, give but that which you yourself propose, and here I take Cordelia by the hand, Duchess of Burgundy.
Nothing. I've sworn. I'm firm.
I'm sorry, then. You've so lost a father that you must lose a husband.
Peace be with Burgundy. Since the respects of fortune are his love, I shall not be his wife.
Fairest Cordelia, art most rich being poor, most choice forsaken, and most love despised. Thee and thy virtues here I seize upon. Be it lawful I take up what's cast away. Gods, gods, 'tis strange that from the coldest neglect my love should kindle to inflamed respect. Thy boundless daughter, king, thrown to my chance, is queen of us, of ours, and our fair France. Not all the dukes of Waterish Burgundy can buy this unprized, precious fate of me. Bid them farewell, Cordelia. Though unkind, thou losest here another where to find.
Thou hast her, France. Let her be thine, for we have no such daughter, nor shall we ever see that face of hers again. Therefore be gone, thou art grace, our love, our venison. Come, noble Burgundy.
legitimate. If this letter speed and my invention thrive, Edmund the base shall top the legitimate. I grow. I prosper. Now gods, stand up for bastards. Kent benched, but Francis called the pardon. Edmund, how now? What news?
So please, your lordship, none.
Why seek you so earnestly to put up that letter?
I know no news, my lord.
What paper were you reading?
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing. Nothing hath not such need to hide itself. Come, if it be nothing, I shall not need my spectacles.
I beseech you, sir, pardon me. There's a letter from my brother that I have not all read. And so much as I have perused, I find it not fit for your looking.
Come, give it here.
I shall offend neither to detain or give it.
Let's see, let's see.
I hope, for my brother's justification, that you wrote this but as an essay or a taste of my virtue.
This policy and reverence of age makes the world bitter to the best of our times, keeps our fortunes from us so our oldness cannot relish them. I begin to find an idle and fond bondage in the oppression of age tyranny, whose sway is not as it hath power, but as it is suffered. Come to me, so that of this I may speak more. If my father should sleep till I waked him, you should half his revenue forever, and be beloved of your brother, Edgar. Edgar! My own son! Treason! Had he had him to write this? A heart and mind to breed it in? We came this to you, hurrah!
It was not property, my lord, that is the cunning of it. I found it thrown in at the casement of my closet.
You know the characters to be your brothers.
The matter were good, my lord, I durst swear it were his, but in respect of that, I would fain think it were not.
It is his!
It is his hand, my lord, but I hope his heart is not in the contents.
Ah! Abominable villain! This very letter, this very nature of the letter, unnatural, detested!
Where is he? I do not well know, my lord. It shall please you to suspend your indignation against my brother till you can derive better testimony of his intent. You shall run a certain course. For if you violently proceed against him, mistaking his purpose, you would make a great gap in your own honor and shake in pieces the heart of his obedience. I dare pawn down my life for him if he wrote this to feel my affection to your honor and to no further pretense of danger.
Thank you, sir.
I will seek him, sir, presently. Convey the business as I shall find means and acquaint you with all.
These late eclipses in the sun and moon portends no good to us. Yet nature in its wisdom can reason thus and thus. Yet nature finds itself scorched by the sequent effects. Love cools, friendship falls off, brothers divide. In palaces, mutinies, countries, discord, cities, treason. And the bond cracks twixt son and father. My own villain follows this prediction, their son against father. The king falls from bias of nature, this father against child. We've seen the very best of our time. Now hollowness, machinations, and treachery follow us to our grave. Seek out this villain, Edmund. Do it carefully, shall lose thee nothing. And a noble and true-hearted Kent banished. His events, honestly, it is strange.
This is an excellent foppery of the world. When we are sick, fortune, often the surfeit of our own behavior. We make guilty of our disasters the sun, moon, and stars, as if we were villains by necessity, fools by heavenly compulsion, knaves, thieves, and treacherous by spherical predominance, drunkards, liars, and adulterers by unenforced obedience to planetary influence. All that we are evil in, by some divine thrusting on. An admirable evasion of whoremaster man, to lay his goatish disposition to the chart of the star. Edgar. And pat he comes, like a catastrophe of the divine comedy. My cue is villainous melancholy. Give me a sigh like Tom of Bedlam. Well, these eclipses do portend these divisions.
How now, Brother Edmund? What serious contemplation are you in?
I am thinking, brother, of a prediction I read this other day, what should come with these eclipses.
Do you busy yourself about that?
I assure you, brother, the events he writes of succeed unhappily, as in unnaturalness between the child and the parent, death, dearth,
disillusions of ancient enemies, menaces and maledictions against kings and nobles, and needless differences, banishment of friends, dissipation of cohorts, nuptial breaches, and I know not what.
How long have you been a secretary after home?
Come, come. When saw you my father last?
Why, the night gone by.
Spake you with him?
Aye, to ask you.
Parted you in good terms? Found you no displeasure in him by word or countenance?
No, none at all.
If you think yourself where you may have offended him, at my entreaty, forbear his presence till you can derive better testimony of his intent, which at this moment so rageth in him that with the mischief of your person I could scarcely allay.
Some devil hath done me wrong!
That's my fear, I pray you. Retire with me to my lodgings, for once I will fitly bring you to hear my master speak. Pray you, go. If you do stir abroad, go armed.
Armed? Brother?
Brother, I do advise you to desist. Go armed. I am no honest man if there be any good meaning towards you.
Shall I refuse you anon?
I do serve you in this business. A credulous father and a brother noble, whose nature is so far from doing harms that he suspects none, on whose foolish honesty my practices ride easy. I know the business. Let me, if not by birth, have lands by wit. All within these meet that I can fashion fit.
Did my father strike my gentleman for the training of the school?
Yes, ma'am.
By day and night he wrongs me. I'm a longer endurance. His knights go riotous. Himself upbraids us on every trifle. When he returns from hunting, I will not speak with him. Say, I am sick.
He's coming, madam. I hear him.
Throng a weary negligence, you and your fellows. Now, by my life, old fools are bathed again. We must be used with checks as flatteries when they are so abused. Remember what I tell you.
Well, madam.
And let the knights of cold looks among you. But, fellow self, I'll write straight to my sister to hold my very course. Prepare for dinner!
But as well I other accents borrow, that can my speech diffuse. My good intent may carry through itself to that full issue for which I raise my lightness. Now, banished Kent, if thou canst serve without thou stand condemned, so may it come thy master, whom thou lovest, shall find thee full of labors.
Let me stay on a job for dinner. Go get it ready.
Oh, no, what art thou?
A man, sir.
What dost thou profess? What's that with us?
I do profess to be no less than I seem. To love him truly, that will remain a trust. To serve him that is honest, and to eat no fish.
What art thou?
A very kind-hearted fellow, sir, and as poor as a king.
If thou be'st poor for a subject, as he is for a king, thou art poor enough. What wouldst thou?
Service, my lord.
Who wouldst thou serve?
You.
Ah, dost thou know me, fellow?
No, sir, but you have that in your accountants which I would fain call master.
What's that?
Authority.
What services can thou do?
I can keep honest counsel, ride, run, mar a curious tale intelligent, and deliver a plain message bluntly, and the best of means diligence.
How old art thou?
Not so young, sir, to love a woman for singing, nor so old to dote on her for
anything. Follow me. Thou shalt serve me, and if I like thee no worse after dinner, I'll not part from thee yet. Dinner, ho, dinner! Go you and call my fool hither.
You, sir, come you hither, sir.
Who am I, sir?
My lady's father.
My lady's father. My lord's name, you whoresome dog, you slave cur.
I am none of these things, my lord. I beseech your pardon.
Dost thou ban me? Looks at me, you rascal!
My lord,
trample
me! You base football player.
Thou servest me, fellow, and I'll love thee.
Come, sir, arise, away. I'll teach you differences. Away!
How now, my friendly neighbors? Earnest of thy service.
Oh, let me hire him to bear my box.
Oh, how now, my pretty name, how dost thou?
Sir, you were best take my costume.
Why?
Why, for taking one's heart is out of favor. Nay, and thou canst not smile until he sits, thou'll get cold shortly. There, take my costume. Why, this fellow has banished two one's daughters and did the third a blessing against his will. Thou follow him, thou must needs wear my costume. How now, Hogoboom? Would I had two costumes and two daughters?
Why, my boy?
Well, if I gave them all my living, I'd keep my costume to myself.
Heed Sirrah the whip.
Oh, true, Sir Dog must to kennel, he must be whipped.
Excellent, go with me.
Sir, I'll teach thee a speech.
Do.
Mark it now. Have more than thou showest to speak less than thou knowest, lead less than thou owest, grab more than thou owest, learn more than thou owest, set less than thou owest, plead thy drink and thy whore, and keep it a door, and thou shalt have more than two tenants to a score.
This is nothing, fool.
Oh, well then, it is like the brag of an unfeigned lawyer, you gave me nothing for it. Can you make no use of nothing, uncle?
Why, no, my boy, nothing can come out of nothing.
Oh, could he tell him, so much the rent of his land comes to, we will not believe a fool.
Bitter fool.
Does that have a difference, my boy, between bitter fool and sweet fool?
No, lad, teach me.
That lord that counseled thee to give away thy land, come listen here by me. Do thou for his sake. The sweet and bitter fool will presently appear. The one in motley here, the other found out, there.
Dost thou call me fool, boy?
All thy other titles thou hast given away, that thou hast born with. And I'll give thee 2 crowns.
And what 2 crowns shall they be?
Well, when I cut the egg in the middle and eat up the meat, the 2 crowns in the egg. When thou clovest that crown in the middle and gavest away both parts, thou borest thy ass on thy back over the dirt. Thou hadst little wit in thy bald crown when thou gavest thy golden one away. Fools had ne'er less wit in the ear, for wise men are grown foppish. They know not how their wits to wear, their manners are so apish.
When were you so wont to be full of songs, sirrah?
I have used it, uncle, ever since thou madest thy daughters thy mothers. For when thou gavest them the rod and pulls down thine own breeches, the name of sudden joined to weep and after sorrow sung, that such a king should play bo peep and go the fools among. Prithee, uncle, have a schoolmaster that will teach thy fool to lie. I would fain learn to lie.
And you lie, sirrah, we'll have you whipped.
I marvel at what kin thou and thy daughters are. They'll have me whipped for speaking true, thou'll have me whipped for lying, and sometimes I'm whipped for holding my peace. I'd rather be any other kind of thing than a fool. And yet, I would not be thee, uncle. Thou hast paired thy wit of both sides and left nothing in the middle. Oh, here comes one of the parents.
Oh, how now, my daughter? What makes that frontlet on? Methinks you're much too late to frown.
Not only, sir, this, you're all licensed fool, but other of your insolent retinue do hourly carp and quarrel, bring me forth in rank and not to be endured by it. Sir, I have thought, by making this well known unto you, to have found a stake for trust, but now grow fearful of what you yourself have too late spoke and done.
Oh, dost any here know me? I would learn that, for by the marks of sovereignty, knowledge, and reason, I should be false persuaded I had daughters.
Which they will make an obedient father.
Your name, fair gentlewoman.
This admiration, sir, is much of the savor of other your new pranks. I do beseech you to understand my purposes aright. As you are old and reverend, you should be wise. Here do you keep 100 knights and squires, men so disordered, so debauched and bold, that this, our court, infected with their manners, shows like a riotous inn. Epicurism and lust, making it more like a tavern or a brothel than a graced palace. The shame itself doth speak for instant remedy. Be then desired by her that else will take the thing she begs. A little to disquantity your train.
Darkness and devil, saddle my horses, call my train together. Degenerate bastard, I will not trouble thee, yet I have left a daughter.
You strike my people, and your disordered rabble make servants of their fetters.
Woe, that too late repents. Oh, sir, are you come as if your will speak, sir?
Pray, sir, I am guiltless as I am ignorant of what hath moved me.
Life and death. I'm ashamed that thou hast power to shake my manhood thus. These hot tears that break from me perforce to make thee worth them. Flash of false upon thee! The untended woundings of a father's curse pierce every sense about thee. Old fond eyes, beweep this cause again, I'll pluck ye out and cast you with the waters that you lose to temper clay. Yea, it has come to this, let it be so. Yet I have left a daughter who I'm sure is kind and comfortable. When she shall hear this of thee with her nails, she'll flay thy wolfish visage. Thou shalt find that I'll resume the shape which thou dost think I've cast off forever. Thou shalt, I warrant thee.
Gentlemen. harmful mildness.
How far your eyes may pierce, I cannot tell. Striving to better, oft we mar as well.
Go you before Gloucester with these letters. Wait my daughter no further with anything you know that comes from her demand out of the letter. If your diligence be not speedy, I shall be there for you.
I will not sleep, my lord, until I come with your letters.
Men's brains were in zeal, were not made for a first fight?
Aye, boy.
Then after thee be married, I wish I'll ne'er go slipshod.
Let me not be mad. Not mad, sweet heavens, give me a temper, I would not be mad. How comes that?
Nay, I know not. You have heard of the news abroad. I mean the whispered ones. For they are yet to be ear kissing arguments.
Not, I pray you, what are they?
You have heard of no likely wars toward twixt the Duke of Cornwall and Albany.
Not a word.
You may do that in time. Fare you well, sir.
The Duke be here tonight. Better, the best. This weaves itself perforce into my business. My father hath set guard to take my brother, and I have one thing of a queasy question which I must act. Briefness and fortune work. Brother, descend! Brother, work! Sir, fly this place. Intelligence is given when you work in. You have now the good advantage of the night. Have you not spoken against the Duke of Cornwall? He comes here now, in the night, in the haste, and Regan with him. Have you nothing said upon his part against the Duke of Albany? Advise yourself!
But sure, what it not a word!
I hear my father coming, and pardon me, and cunning, I must draw my sword upon you. Draw, see him defend yourself. Now quit you well. Yield!
Come before my father! Light, ho, here!
Fly, brother!
Torches! Torches!
So farewell. Some blood drawn on me.
I have seen drunkards do more than this in sport! Father, father! No help!
Edmund, where is the villain?
Fled this way.
After him, help!
By no means what?
He could persuade me to the murder of your lordship. But that I spoke with how manifold and strong a bond the child is bound to the parent, sir, and fine, seeing how loathly opposite I stood his unnatural purpose. In fell motion, with his prepared sword, he charges home my unprovided body. Lance mine arm, but seeing my best alarmed spirits, bold in the quarrel's right, roused to the encounter, or whether ghasted by the noise I made, well, suddenly he fled.
Let him fly far, not in this land shall he remain uncaught. My Duke, the Master, comes tonight. By his authority, I will proclaim it, that he who assists in the capture of this murderous coward shall receive our thanks. He that assists in death. Hark, trumpets. I don't know why the Duke comes. All ports are barred. The village should not escape.
How now, my noble friends? Since I've come hither, which I can call but now, and heard some strange news.
Sir, if it be true, all vengeance comes too short which can pursue the offender.
Oh, madam, my heart is cracked. It is cracked.
What, did my father's godson seek your life? He whom my father named, your Edgar?
Oh, lady, she would have it here.
Was he not companion with the riotous knights that attend upon my father?
I know not.
Yes, madam, he was of that consort.
Marvel then, though he were ill affected. 'Tis they who put him on the old man's death, that have the expense and waste of his revenues. I have this present evening from my sister been well informed of them, and with such cautions that if they come to sojourn in my house, I'll not be there.
Nor I, surely, Regan. Edmund, here you've shown your father a childlike office.
'Twas my duty, sir.
He did bray his practice to receive this hurt that you see, striving to apprehend him.
Is he pursued?
I don't know.
If he be taken, he shall nevermore be feared of doing harm.
Make your own purpose out of my strength, you please. As for you, Edmund, whose virtue and obedience doth this instant so much commend itself, you shall be ours. Natures of such deep trust we shall much need, and you, my first seize upon.
I shall serve you, sir, truly, however else.
For him I thank your grace.
We know not why we came to visit you.
Thus out of season, wedding dark-eyed night. Occasions, noble Gloucester, of some poise, wherein we must make use of your advice. Our father, he hath writ, so hath our sister, of differences, which I least thought it fit to answer from our home. Several messengers from hence came to dispute. To your good old friend, lay comforts to your bosom, and bestow your needful counsel to our business, which craves the instant use.
I serve you, madam. Your grace is all right welcome. Dawning to thee, friend, art of this house?
Aye.
Where may we set our horses?
In the mire.
Prithee, thou lovest me, tell me.
Oh, fellow, I love thee not.
Why, then, I care not for thee.
If I had thee in a lipsbury pinfold, I'd make thee care for thee.
Why dost thou use me thus? I know thee not.
Oh, fellow, I know thee.
What dost thou know me for?
A knave, a rascal, an ear of broken meats, a lily-livered action-taking knave, one that was to be a bard in way of good service, and art nothing but the composition of a knave, beggar, pander, coward, and the errant son of a mongrel bitch!
What a monstrous fellow art thou thus to rail on one that is neither known of thee nor knows thee.
What a brazen-faced varlet art thou to deny thou knowest me. Is it yet 2 days ago since I tripped up thy heels and beat thee before the king? Draw, you rogue, for yet it be night, yet the moon shines, I'll make a sop of the moonshine.
Away, I have nothing to do with thee.
Draw, you rascal, you come with letters against the king, and take Vanity the puppet's part against the royalty of her father. Draw, you rogue, or I'll so carbonado your shanks. Stand, you neat slave, strike! Ah!
Ah! Help!
Ah!
Come, bring out the stocks.
Sir, I beseech your grace not to do so. It's false as much, and the good king's master will be checked.
I'll answer that.
At this term, we receive it much more. That her gentleman abused, assaulted, for following her affairs. Put in his arms. Come, my good lord.
My friend, I am sorry. 'Tis the Duke's pleasure, whom all the world knows will not be rubbed nor stopped. I'll entreat thee.
Pray, sir, do not. I've watched and traveled hard. Some time I shall sleep out, the rest I'll whistle. A good man's fortune may grow out of heels. Give me good morrow.
'Tis the Duke's fault. It's not be ill taken.
I heard myself proclaimed by the happy hollow of a tree. Escape the hut. No port is free, no place to guard. Most the usual vigilance does not attend my taking. Walls I may escape. I will serve myself, and am thought to assume the poorest, most despised shape that ever penury and contempt of man brought near to beast. My face of one with filth of all my hair in knots. Blanket my loins with presented nakedness, outface the winds and persecutions of the sky. The country is in proof of presence of bedlam beggars who have roaring voices striking their numbed and mortified pharaohs, pins, wooden pricks, nails, sprigs of rosemary. And with this horrible object, the low farms, poor pelting villages, she-coats in the mill, sometime with lunatic bands, sometime with prayer, enforce their charity. Poor Turley God! Poor Tom. That's something yet. Edgar, I nothing am.
It is strange that they should so depart from home and not send back my messenger.
Hail to thee, noble master!
Mayest thou shame thy pleasure?
No, my lord.
You wear cruel garters. Horses are tied by the heads, dogs and mares by the neck, monkeys by the loins, and men by the legs. When a man's o'er lusty at legs, then he wears gilded stocks.
Who's he that is so much thy place in the soot to set thee here?
It is both he and she, thy son and daughter.
No.
Yes.
No, I say.
I say yea.
No, no, they would not.
Yes, yes, they have.
By Jupiter, I swear no.
By Juno, I swear I.
They durst not do it. They could not, would not do it. 'Tis worse than murder, than to do upon respect such violent outrage. Resolve me, with all modest haste, which way thou mightst deserve, or they impose this usage coming from us.
My lord, when at their house, I did commit upon them your highness's letters, which presently they read, and having met there the other messenger, whose welcome I perceived with poisoned mind, this being the very fellow that of late has spoken out so saucily against your highness, I, having more man than wit about me, drew. He raised the house with loud and coward cries. Your son and daughter saw this shame worth the trespass which here suffers.
Oh, how this mother rises towards my heart, but where is this daughter?
In here, sir, the door within.
Follow me not, stay there.
How chance the king come with such small a train?
Oh, and thou hast been set in stocks for that question, thou hast well deserved it.
Why?
We'll send thee to school to an aunt, teach thee there's no labor in the winter. All that follow their noses are led by their eyes, but blind them. And there's not a nose among 20 but can smell him that's stinking. Let go thy hold when a great wheel runs downhill, lest it break thy neck with following it. Great one that rolls up the hill, let him drop, yeah. When a wise man gives thee better counsel, give him mine again. Out of none but knaves follow it, since it's in the that sir which serves and seeks for gain and follows but for form, will pack when it begins to rain and leave thee in storm. But I will tarry. The fool will stay and let the wise man fly. The knave turns fool that runs away. The
They are sick, they are weary, they have traveled all night from your fetches, the images of revolt and flying off, fetch me a better answer.
But how informed them so well?
Informed them? Dost thou understand me, fellow? Give me my servant for now, presently. Tell the Duke of Cornwall to speak with him and his wife, for at their chamber door I'll beat the drum to cry sleep to death.
But how about well twisted?
My heart, my rising heart, down.
Cry to it, uncle. As the cockney did to the eels when she put them in the paste alive. She snapped over the coxcomb with a stick and cried, down, Watkins, down! Was her brother back in pure kindness to his horse, buttered his hay?
Oh, good morrow to you both.
And hail to your grace.
I'm glad to see your highness.
I think you are, Regan. I think I know what reason I have to think so. If thou shouldst not be glad, I would divorce me from thy mother's tomb, sepulchre and adulteress.
I pray you, sir, take patience. I hope you less know how to value her desert than she has scanned my duty.
Say, how is that?
I cannot think my sister in the least would fail her obligation. If perchance you have restrained the lives of your followers, it is on such ground and to such wholesome end as clears her from all blame.
My curse is on her.
Oh, sir, you are old. Nature in you stands on the very verge of a confine. You should be ruled and led by some discretion that discerns your state better than you yourself. Therefore, I pray that to her sister you may return. Say you wronged her, sir.
Ask her forgiveness. Do you but mark how this becomes the house? Dear daughter, I confess that I am old. Age is unnecessary. Here on my knees, I beg that you'll vouchsafe me raiment, bed, and food.
Good sir, no more. These are unsightly tricks.
Never, Regan. She hath abated me of half my train, struck me with her tongue, most serpent-like, upon the very heart, looked black upon me. All the stored vengeance of heaven followed her ungrateful. Strike her young bones, you taking airs with lameness.
Oh, bless God, so will you wish on me when the rash mood is on.
No, Regan, thou shalt never have my curse. Thy tender, hefted nature shall not give thee o'er to harshness. Her eyes are fierce, but thine do comfort, not burn.
Sirs, for purpose.
Who stalks my servant?
What chant is that?
I know it, my sister. Proves her letter. She would soon be here.
This is a slave whose easy borrowed pride dwells in the fickle graces of her he follows. Now varlet from my sight.
What means your grace?
Who stalked my servant, Regan? I have good hope thou dost not know on. Oh heavens, who comes here? Art thou not ashamed to look upon this beard? Oh, Regan, will thou take her by the hand?
Why not by the hand, sir? How have I offended? All's not offense that indiscretion finds and dotage turns so.
You are too tough, will you? Yet hold, how came my man into the stocks?
I set him there, sir. But his own disorders deserved much less advancement.
You? Did you?
Pray you, father, we seem so. If to the expiration of your month you will return and sojourn with my sister, dismissing half your train, come then to me.
Return to her? And 50 men dismissed? No. Rather I abjure. Choose to wage against the enmity of the heir. Turn to her, persuade me rather to be slave and sumpter to this detested groom.
At your choice, sir.
Prithee, daughter, do not make me mad. I will not trouble thee, my child. Farewell. We'll no more speak, no more see each other. Yet thou art still my flesh, my blood, my child, or rather a disease that's in my flesh, which I must needs call mine. Thou art boiled, plague sore, an embossed carbuncle in my corrupted blood. But I'll not chide thee, no. Let shame come when it will. I will not call it. I can be patient. I can stay with Regan and hide my hunger.
Well, not altogether so. I looked not for you yet, nor am provided for your fit welcome. What, sir, 50 followers? Is it not well? What should you need of more? Yea, you're so many, sit the book charge and danger speak against so great a number. How could many people under two commands in one household amity? It is hard, almost impossible. Why might not you, my lord, receive attendance from those that she calls servants, or from mine? Why not, sir? Then if they chance to slap you, we can control them. If you come to me, for now I spy danger, I entreat you to bring but 25. To no more will I be placed or notice.
I gave you all.
Good times, gave it.
I will go with thee. Thy 50 yet doth double 5 and 20, and thou art twice her love.
Hear me, my lord. What need you 5 and 20? 10 or 5 in a house where twice so many have a command to tend you? What need one?
Oh, reason not the need. Our basest beggars are the poorest things superfluous. Allow not nature more than nature needs. Man's life's as cheap as beasts. You see me here, you gods. A poor old man. He's full of grief as age. Wretched in both. No, you unnatural hags. I will have such revenges on you both that all the world shall. I will do such things. What they are, yet I know not. They shall be the terrors of the earth. And though we weep, no. I'll not weep, though I have full cause of weeping. This heart shall break into 100,000 flaws ere I'll weep. Shall go mad.
I must withdraw to the storm.
Where's my love, Foster?
Follow the old man forth. He's returned.
The king's in high rage.
Whither is he going?
I know not well with him, but he calls the horse.
But the old man go. He needs his way.
Sir, to willful men, the injuries that they themselves procure must be their schoolmasters. Shut up your doors, for he is attended with a desperate train, and what the maid sends him to, being apt to have his ear abused, wisdom bids fear.
Shut up your doors, my lord.
Alack, the night comes on, bleak winds and sort of ruffled.
Tis a wild night. My Regan counsels well. Come out of the storm.
Ten minutes, thank you.
Supposed to shut off after half an hour.
Did you shut it off?
No, it just went off automatically.
Did
and
you start filming?
Yeah, okay. yeah, no. It only missed like 10, 15 seconds.
Was it my 10, 15 seconds?
No. Oh, Ben, you look so good.
Hi,
this.
Mom. Just kidding.
John just got it.
Rick Kenny?
Those bitch niggas thought we couldn't do it. Nigga, we made it.
fighting, but especially to the end. I mean, actually, the second half is really interesting how it staged it. But yeah, I think when you deliver your monologues, right, just think about all people all around. Yeah,
absolutely.
And just and you talk to people, especially you. You talk to the audience. And and you, yeah, you're crazy. So now pretend they're all like big ones here.
Aside, okay. Can I give them to like one person? Is that okay?
For what?
Side.
Yeah, I really like Try to do
them on
stage. Are you ready?
What? Yeah.
I can understand you. I can understand everyone really well. Quasi, just remember not to see it next time.
Do you like the kisses on Quincy?
What happened? No.
He said,
I kind of like that actually.
How you feeling, Aggie?
I'm feeling pretty good. I'm feeling pretty like heart beating, but I'm good. It's a good thing.
Is there any questions?
You said that they can hear me?
No. I can hear you. I just want to make sure. Do you hear me okay? Yeah. Yeah, I can hear everyone. How are you doing?
I'm filming.
That's good.
It's a document.
I did not think I would.
It's Lear.
Yeah, guys.
Struggle.
It was so huge.
Show me that Cornwall purse.
Augustus, you were so nervous. Baby was so nervous. Yeah, wait. Just to let you know, guys, we had to turn away 15 people.
15?
Yeah, no, it's really fucking full out there.
First of all, it's a fire hazard in my house. But second of all, we can all standing in the way when you're running around and people come back.
Do you remember where the students
are? That being said, we're gonna have to do like a real show on Sunday.
Yeah, I don't wanna do it backwards on Sunday because this is so fucking good.
Wait, who was it?
I don't know, just probably.
Were they students or?
Okay,
yeah, they're students. They were. There are like four alums in the audience who are all like before. I think.
Yeah, I've seen a couple.
But they're like, they're dancing.
So if anyone has friends who are like trying to come twice, don't have them be there.
Well,
yeah.
But also, I think, can we make a policy for people coming from out of town and passing?
Yeah, here's the thing. I need next time.
Yeah,
need
this, but like, no.
Yo, those are mine. I left those here while I was hooking up.
Yo, damn, I got that backwards.
Yo, bitch that he brought here, this is all for you. This one's for you. This one's for you.
Kenny, how you feeling?
Feeling all right. Just going through the lines.
Yeah, man.
Plus, it's not your mom. Oh, but the good news is...
No!
Paxton!
I hate when I can't read.
Hey, man.
Hey, how you guys liking the show?
Wait. Booty. It's a good show.
I haven't seen any blood yet.
How you feeling, Kieran?
Holy water in a dry house is better than this rainwater out of door.
would not go in and ask thy daughter's blessing. Here's a knight pities neither wise man
nor fool. Rumble thy belly full, spit, fire, spout, rain. No rain, wind, thunder, fire are my darts. I do not tax your elements with unkindness. I never gave you king. Called you children, you owe me no subscription. Therefore, let fall your horrible pleasure. Here I stand, your slave, a poor despised, weak old man.
He that has a house to put head in has a good headpiece. A cod piece that will howl before the hen has any. And he shall louse, so beggars marry men.
Who's there?
Mary, here's grace in a codpiece. It's a wise man that fall.
Alas, sir, is that you? Things that love night look not nights such as these. In the wrathful skies, the owls bear the wanderers of the dark and make them keep their caves. Since I was a man, such sheets of fire, such bursts of horrid thunder, such groans of roaring wind and rain, I never remember to have heard. Man's nature cannot carry the affliction nor the fear.
Let the great gods keep this dreadful father o'er our heads. Find out their enemies now. Tremble, thou wretch, that hast within thee undivulged crimes and whipped of justice. Hide thee, thou bloody hand, thou perjured, and thou similar man of virtue that art incestuous. Caitiff to pieces shake, and under covert convenient seeming practiced on man's life. Drive your concealing continence, close pent-up guilts, and cry those dreadful summoners grace. I'm a man more sinned against than sinning.
Alack, gracious sir, hard by, here is a hovel. Some friendship will lend you against the tempest.
My wits begin to turn. Come, my boy, how dost, my boy, art cold? I am cold myself. Where's the straw, fellow? The art of our necessities is strange, that makes the vile things seem precious. Come, your hovel.
Poor fool and knave. I have one part of my heart that's sorry yet for me.
You the cat and the little tiny wink. With hay, foam, the wind, and the rain, shall make content your misfortune's fate. For the rain it raineth every day.
Shall have my revenge on that potter's house.
Come, my lord. I may be censured, but nature thus keeps place loyal. Something fears me to think of.
I now perceive it is not altogether your brother's evil disposition that made him seek his death. Provoking there, set at work by a reprovable badness in himself.
How malicious is my fortune that I must repent to be just. Here is the letter he spoke of, which proves an intelligent argument to the advantage of France.
Go with me to the Duchess.
The matter in this paper be certain. You have mighty business to attend.
True, false, yes, may be. Oh, Gloucester. Seek out thy father, that he may be ready for a power of apprehension.
If I find him comforting the king, it will stop his suspicion more fully. I will persevere in my course of loyalty, though the matter be sore between that and my blood.
Will they trust upon me? Thou shalt find your father, my lord. Here's a place, my lord. Good, my lord, enter. The tyranny of the open night's too rough for nature to endure.
Prithee, go in thyself. Seek thine owners. Your house is poverty. In, boy, go first. I'll pray and then I'll speak. Poor naked wretches, wheresoever you are, divide the pelting of this pitiless storm. Expose thyself to feel what wretches feel. Thou mayst shake the superflux to thee and show the heavens more just.
Water!
Prithee, thou glorious spirit! Oh, help me, help me!
Give me thy hand, who's there?
A spirit? A spirit? He says his name's poor Tom.
You there, what art thou that doth grumble in the straw? Come forth. Away, foul fiend! Follows me.
Cool, sharp hawthorn toes cold, and all those that cold beds in the
What is
thou given all to thy two daughters, and art thou come to this?
Who gives anything to poor Tom, whom the foul fiend led through fire, through flame, through foreign whirlpool, or bogged in quagmire, that played knives under his low halters in his hue, set arsenic on his forge, made film proud of arch round the main tiny ones from forest bridges, to course his own shadow for a traitor. Oh, bless thy five wits, bless thee, masters, from whirlwind star blasted, and take, and do poor Tom's maturity in the foul fiend. And there!
Have his two daughters brought him to this pass?
Sir, he hath four daughters.
Damn traitor. Nothing this to do nature to such an unkind lowness produced two daughters. Is it the fashion that discarded fathers should have thus little mercy on their flesh? It was this flesh that begot those pelican daughters.
Pelican sound, pelican hill, a little.
This cold night shall turn us all
to
fools and madmen.
Take heed of the foul fiend, obey thy parents, commit not with man's sworn spouse, send not thy heart on powder air.
How's cold?
What hast thou been?
A serving man, proud in heart and mind, that curled my hair, wore gloves in my cap, and served the lust of my mistress's heart. One that swore as many oaths as I spake words, and broke them in the sweet face of heaven that slept in the contriving of lust and wit to do it. Oh, let not the rustling of silks or the creaking of shoes betray thy heart's woman. Keep thy hand out of vice, thy foot out of ruffles, thy pen from lender's books. Defy the foul fiend, still through the hawthorn, those cool wind.
Thou wert better in thy grave than to answer with thy uncovered flesh this extremity in disguise. Consider him well. Thou owest the sheep no wool, the beast no hide, the cat no perfume. There's three on are sophisticated. An accommodated man is no more than such a poor, bare-forked animal as thou art. Oh, off, off, you lendings! Come on, button here!
Pretty now will be contented. 'Tis a naughty night to swim in. A little fire in a wild field will light no lender's heart. A small spark. All the rest of his body cold. Look, here comes a walking fire.
Who goes there? What is it you see?
What out there? Your name's?
Poor Tom! That eats the swimming frog, the tadpole, the worm, and the water. Perhaps it might such small deer, but Tom's food to set him along with beer. Beware my follower. Please! Smoke him! Taste thou fiend!
What? Hath your grace no better company?
Perhaps the darkness is young.
Our flesh and blood has grown so vile that it doth hate what gets it so.
Oh, it's cold.
My lord, I cannot bear all your daughter's hard commands. Let their injunction be for me to bar my doors and let this tyrannous night take hold upon you. Then I come and sought you out to bring you both fire and food is ready.
I will speak a moment with this learned philosopher. Tell me, what is the cause of thunder?
Good, my lord, take his offer, no order.
I will speak with this learned Theban. What is thy study?
How to prevent the fiend. And to kill vermin.
Talk a moment with you in private.
The fortune him wants more to go, my lord, his wits begin to unsettle. Canst thou blame him? His daughters seek his death. Ah, poor banished Kent! He said this would happen.
Yes.
You say he begins to grow mad. I believe I begin to grow mad myself. My son, lately he sought my death. Yet lately, friends, I begin to love him.
Times are cold.
Fellow, go into the hovel, keep thee warm.
Come, let's and all.
Yes, sir, this way.
With him, I will keep still with my philosopher.
Go, take him you are.
Come, good Athenian.
Come, let's all in.
Make no noise, draw the curtains, so. We'll go to supper in the morning, so.
I'll draw into the dark tower cane. Heart was still, by bow and bone, I saw the blood of an English man.
And I'll go to bed at noon.
For speed to my lord, dear husband, show me this letter. He held me a fancy blade. Seek out that villain, Glouchester.
Hang him instantly. Pluck out his eyes.
Leave him to my displeasure. And keep you our sister company. The vengeance we are bound to take upon your traitor's father, not fit for your beholding. How now? Where's the king?
My lord of Gloucester hath conveyed him hence. From 5 or 6 and 30 this night's hot questions after. Met him at gate, who with some other lords of attendants are gone from Port Dover, where they boast to have well armed friends.
His course is for your mistress.
Farewell, sweet one. And sister? Edmund. Farewell. Oh, sweet betrayer, Gloucester! Pinion him like a thief! Bring him before us!
Though well we may not pass upon his life without the form of justice, that our power shall do in courtesy to our ravage. Men may blame, but not control!
Who is there? The traitor!
Ungrateful!
Fight fast, Cordelia. Your graces, consider you are my friends. Do me no harm.
Find him, I say.
Our filthy traitor.
Oh, unmerciful lady, as you are, I am none.
To this chair, bind him. Villain, what letters have you laid from France?
Be simple, answerer. We know the truth.
What confederacy have you with the traitors? Lay foot in the kingdom.
To whose hands have you sent the lunatic king?
I have a letter guessingly sent down from one of a neutral heart, not one opposed.
Come here.
And false!
Where hast thou sent the king?
To Dover.
Wherefore to Dover, sir? Was that the charge?
Let him answer that first.
I am tied to the stake, and I must stand the course.
Wherefore to Dover, sir?
I would not see thy cruel nails pluck out his poor old eyes, nor thy sister's boorish fangs and his anointed flesh stick. But I would see that the winged vengeance overtake such children.
Fear thou shalt never. Fellows, hold the chair. On those eyes of thine I shall set my foot.
He that they slips when you go, give me some strength. Oh, God! Oh! Oh, oh my God!
Owes nothing to thy glass. But
Who comes here?
My father. Poor little lad. Oh, world. World. But that thy strange mutations may his faith bleed, life will not yield age.
Oh, fellow, come hither. No stop waits over.
Both down the gate, worse way in footpath. Bless you, good son, from the foul fiend. Poor Tom has been scared out of his good wits. Five fiends have been in poor Tom at once. Of lust, as a bedekit, Hopidinus, prince of dumbness, Mahu of stealing, Modo of murder, and Flippy Gibbet of mobbing and moaning, who sense possesses chambermaids and waiting women. So bless thee, master.
What dost thou know, Dover?
I, master.
There's a cliff whose high and bending lead looks fearfully over the confined deep. Bring me but to the very brim of it. From that place I shall the leading lead.
Give me thy arm. More time shall lead me. The son of a man, Christine answered, to storm your sister.
One way I like this well. But my sister being widowed and my Gloucester with her, may all the building and my fancy pluck upon my hateful life. Another way, the news is not so tart. I will read and fly.
Where was his son when they did take his ox?
Come with my lady hither.
He is not here.
No, my lord, I've been back again.
Knows he the wickedness?
Aye, 'twas he informed against them. He quit the house on purpose so that the punishment might have the freer course.
Gloucester, I live to thank thee for the love thou showest the king, and to revenge thine eyes. Come hither, friend. Tell me what more thou knowest.
When shall we come to the top of that same hill?
We come upon it now. Look how we labor.
Methinks the ground is even.
Horrible steep. Hark! Do you hear the sea?
No, truly.
Why then your other senses grow imperfect by your eyes' anguish?
So may it be indeed. Methinks thy voice is altered. Must be some better phrase of matter than thou didst.
You're much deceived. In nothing am I changed but in my garments. Come, sir. Stand. Here is the spot. Ooh. How fearful and dizzy 'tis to cast one's eyes. So low, the crows and choughs that wing the midway air shall scarce over us as beetles. Halfway down hangs one that gathers sapphire. Dreadful trade. Methinks he seems no bigger than his head. And the fishermen that walk upon the beach appear as mice. And yon tall anchoring bark, diminished to her cock, a buoy almost too small for sight. And the murmuring surge down the unnumbered idle pebbles chafes cannot be heard. I'll look down no more, lest my brain turn, and the deficient sight top down headlong.
This is semi where you stand.
Here, sir. You are now within a foot of the extreme verge. For all beneath the moon would I not leap upright.
Thank you, sir. Here is a jewel, well worth a poor man's taking. Take it, go, and prosper. Let me hear the bleeding.
Very well, sir.
Come with all my heart!
Why do you try to thus this despair is done to cure?
Oh, gods, here I kneel before you and shake patiently my great affliction off. If I could bear longer my stuff and loathed heart of nature should burn itself out. If I could live, oh, bless him. Now, gods, fare thee well!
Gods, everyone! May rob the treasury of life and life itself he lives to defend. Had he been but where he thought, by this thought and past. Alive or dead? Here, you, sir! Ho, sir, you! Speak! Oh, that's mighty past indeed, yet he revives. Speak, sir, what are you?
Away and let me die.
Had thou been aught but gossamer, feathers, and air, so many fathoms downward precipitating, thou shivered like an egg. But thou dost breathe, have heavy substance, speaks, art sound. 10 masts at each make about the altitude which thou perpendicular to fail. Thy life is a miracle. Speak yet again. Have I fallen or no?
Aye, from the dread summit of the chalk horn.
Look up, aye. The shrill boomer's heart so far cannot be seen or heard. Do but look up.
Alack, I have no eyes. Is wretchedness deprived that benefit to end its like death?
Oh. So, how is it? Feel your legs, you stand.
Oh, too well, too well.
Whew. This is beyond all strangeness. Tell me, upon the contrary, what thing was that which parted from you?
A poor, fortunate beggar.
And thou stood here below, and thought his eyes were two full moons. He had a thousand noses, horns, his wealth, and waiting to see him reach the sea. This was some fiend, therefore thou happy father. Think that the clearest gods who make themselves honors men's impossibilities have preserved you.
I remember that. Henceforth, I'll bear affliction so that you cry itself out. Away, away, and let me die.
You're free and patient thoughts. But who comes here? Oh, the saints.
No, they cannot touch me for
son.
Nature's above all in that respect. That fellow draws his bow like a crow keeper. Draw me a Clothier's yard. Look! Look, a mouth!
Peace, peace,
a piece of toast and cheese will do it. Bring up my gauntlet. I'll prove it on a giant. Bring up the brown pills, oh, well, flown bird.
The trick of that voice I do well remember. This is not the king.
Aye. Every inch a king. When I do stare, see how the subject quakes. I pardon that man's life. What was thy cause? Adultery? Thou shalt not die for it. Die for adultery? No! Let copulation thrive. The wren goes to it. The small gilded fly of lecher in my sight, for Gloucester's bastard son was kinder to his father than my two daughters got to even lawful.
Oh, let me kiss thy hands.
Let me wipe it first. It smells of mortality.
King, nature wears itself out to naught. Dost thou remember me?
I remember thine eyes well enough. Dost thou swine me at thee? No. The first blind cupid, all not blood. Read thou this challenge, mark with penny.
Alack, for all the letters sons, I could not see what.
Breathe.
What, the case of eyes?
Yo, you were there with me? Your eyes in a heavy case, your purse in a light? You had no eyes in your head, nor no money in your purse, yet you see how this world goes.
I see it feeling.
What? Art mad? A man may see how this world goes with no eyes. Look with thine ears. See how yon justice rails upon yon sympathy. I know thee well enough. Thy name is Gloucester, thou must be patient. We came crying hither, thou knowest. When we first smell the air, we wall and cry. I'll preach thee, Mark.
Alack the day!
When we are born, we cry that we are come to this great stage of fools. 'Tis good luck. We're a delicate stratagem to shew a troop of horses with felt, but I'll put it in proof. When I have stolen upon these sons-in-law, why then kill, kill, kill! Fetch me a surgeon, I'm cut to the brain.
You shall have anything.
It were a good pass. It were enough to make a man of salt, to use his eyes from God and water pot's eye and cleaning on his dust. But I will die bravely, like a bridegroom. I will be jovial. Come, come, my masters, I am a king. Know you that?
You are a royal one, we obey you.
Why then, there's life in it. Nay, if you get it, you shall be it with running sauce.
Hail, gentle sir.
Sir, speech you. What's your will?
Have you heard aught, sir, of battle's war?
Most sure and vulgar. Everyone hears that which can distinguish sound.
But by your favor, how near is the other army?
Near, and on speedy foot.
I thank you, sir. That is all.
Though the queen is here on special cause, her army is moved on.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, gods, help me! Let not my worst spirit tempt me to die.
Pray you well, father.
Huh? What art thou?
Most poor man, they obtain a fortune of blows, who by the art of knowing human sorrows and pregnant to get thee. Come. I'll lead you to some biting. Poor folk pass. If I should have described it as my life, it would not have been to so long as by a poor man. Nay, come not near your dead. Keep up. I will. I'll be playing with you.
Out! Don't kill!
I'll be playing! Come on, sir! No matter for your fight!
Slave! Villain! Thou hast slain me! Take my purse. If ever thou wilt thrive, take the letters which thou wilt find about me. To Edmund, Earl of Gloucester, upon the British part, we seek him out. Oh, untimely death.
I knew you well, serviceable villain, as duteous to the vices of thy mistress as badness would desire.
Well, is he
dead.
Crushed you, father? Let's see. These pockets. The letters which she speaks of may be our friends. Let us see. Leave, gentle wax, and manners. Blame. It's not. Let our reciprocal vows be remembered. You have many opportunities to cut him off. If your will want not, time and place will be fruitful longer. There is nothing done. If you return the conqueror, then am I his prisoner, his bed, my goal, the low warmth whereof deliver me and supply the place for your labor. Your wife, so I should say, affectionate servant, Goneril. Oh, undistinguished space of a woman's will, a plot upon a virtuous husband's life, and the exchange, my brother!
The king is mad. That's right. Separate me off from such woes.
Come, father. Far off, methinks I hear the beaten drum. There I'll bestow it with a friend.
You make me feel so young. You make me feel so spring.
Oh, God, please. How should I live and work to match such a
knowledge matters over pain. All my resorts go with my honest truth. One more and more clicks. So.
He never stupid. He is beats of every single more sad than we can off.
Ah, but to be known that I'm sure with my main intent, my food I mean. Yeah. It's a time I
think. How does the king?
Madam sleeps still.
My dear father. Restoration, hang thy medicine on my lips, and let this kiss prepare with violent harms those violent arms that my two sisters have in my reverence made. Did you not think their father, these white flakes, had challenged pity of them? Was this a face to be opposed against the roaring winds, to stand against the deep dread bolted thunder, in the most terrible and nimble stroke of quick cross lightning, to watch poor Perdu with this thin helm? My enemy's dog, though he had bitten me, should have stood that night against my fire. And wast thou fain, poor father, to hobble thee with swine and rogues for more than short and musty straw? Alack, alack, 'tis wonder that thy life and wits at once had not concluded all. Wait. How does my lord and lord help finish your majesty?
Do me wrong to take thee out of the grave. But a soul in bliss, but I am bound upon a wheel of fire, and mine with tears do scald like molten lead.
Sir, do you know me?
Pray you. I am a very foolish, fond old man. Speak plainly, I fear I am not in my perfect mind. Methinks I should know you would know this man, yet I am doubtful, for I am chiefly ignorant what place this is, and all the fashion I have remembers not these garments. As I am a man, I think this lady to be my child, Cordelia.
So I am!
Pray you bear with me. Thou must be patient. I am a very foolish, fond old man.
I'd rather lose the war than that sister should loosen him and me.
Our very loving sister. Well, you met. So, this idea. The king has come to his daughter with others whom the rigor of our state have forced to cry out. For I could not be honest, I never yet could doubt it. For this business, it touched us. As France invades our land, God holds the king with others whom I fear was just and heavy causes being proposed.
Sir, you speak nobly.
Why is this reason combined together against the enemy? For these domestic and particular broils are not the question here.
But then determine with the ancient of war proceedings.
I shall attend incredibly at your head.
Sister, you'll go with us? No. Tis most convenient, pray go with us. Oh, I'm a hero. I will go!
Fair grace had speech with one so poor. Hear me one word.
My lord, take me, speak.
One but hope this letter. Where victory and let it sound for he brought. Wretch though I seem, I produce a champion that can prove what was about to be. He was scary, and the voice was cold, the sullen and maceration ceases. Fortune love me.
Stay till I've read the letter.
I was forbid. Let Brother Harold cry when time shall serve.
Why, fare thee well. O Lord, look that paper.
The enemies with you, draw your powers. You can guess their true strength and forces by diligent discovery. Your haste is not urged on you.
We will greet the time.
To both these sisters I have sworn my love. Each jealous of the other is the stung honor of the adder. Which of them shall I take? Both. One. Neither. Neither can be enjoyed if both remain alive. To take the widow exasperates, makes mad her sister Goneril. Hardly can I carry up my side, her husband being alive. Well then, we'll use his countenance for battle, which being done, that she who would be rid of him devise his speedy taking off. And as for the mercy which he intends to Lear and Cordelia, the battle done, and they within our power, shall never see his pardon. For my state stands on me to defend, not to debate.
Like birds in the cage. Without us asking you a blessing, I'll kneel down and ask for you forgiveness. And so we'll live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies and hear poor rogues talk with poor news. And we'll talk with them too. Who loses and who wins, who's in and who's out. We'll take upon the mystery of things if your God spies. And we'll wear out the walled prison, hacks and sets of great ones that ebb and flow by the moon.
Take them away. Come hither, Captain. Hark. Take down this note. Go follow me to prison. One step I have advanced. That dust is this express that makes that way to tell the fortress. But no doubt this, that men are as the tide is. To be tender-minded is not to come a sword. But if say thou endure it, to thrive by other means.
Do it.
you have shown today your valiant strength, and fortune hath led you well. You have the captives that were the opposite of this day's strife. We do require them of you, so to use them, as their merits and our safety may equally determine.
Sir, I thought it fit to send the old and miserable king to some retention and appointed guard, whose age has charms it, whose title more, to pluck the common bosom on his side and turn our impressed lenses in our eyes, which do command them. With him I sent the queen, my reasons all the same. They are ready, tomorrow or at some further space, to appear where you shall hold your session. At this time, we sweat and bleed. The friend hath lost his friend, and the best quarrels, in the heat, are cursed by those who feel their sharpness. The question of Cordelia and her father requires a fitter place.
Sir, by your patience, I hold you as but a subject of this war, not as a brother.
Our pleasure might have been demanded ere you had spoke so far. He led our powers, bore the commission of my place and person, the which immediacy may well stand up and call itself your brother.
Not so hot. In his own grace you have exalted himself.
And so then in your addition, in my rights, by me invested, he compares the best. Oh, that were the most if he should husband to you. Gestures, the all through prophet. Hurrah, hurrah!
Thy valor, thy heart, thou art a traitor, false to thy gods. thy brother, thy father, conspirant against this high illustrious prince, and from the extremest upward of thy hand, the descent and dust below thy foot, the most toad and spotted traitor. Say thou no, and this sword, this arm, and my best spirit are bent to prove upon your heart where to my speak thou liest.
In wisdom I should ask thy name, seeing as thy outside looks so fair and warlike, thy tongue some say of breeding breeds. What safe and nicely I might well delay by rule of knighthood, I disdain and spurn.
Back do I toss these treasons to thy head, and the hell-hated lie overwhelm thy heart, which, for they yet glance by and scarcely bruise, my sword will give them instant way, where they shall rest forever. Trumpets sound! Semblance that very dogs disdain. Met I my father in this habit. His bleeding rings, their precious stones, and lost. I became his guide, led him, begged for him, saved him from despair. Never once, oathful, revealed myself unto him. Until some half hour passed and I was armed, hoping, though not sure, this good success. I asked him his blessing, and from the first to the last told him my pilgrimage. Alack, this flawed heart too weak, conflict to support. Twixt two extremes of passion, joy, and grief, burst smilingly.
Help! Help! Help!
What sword, thou?
Speak, man!
What means that bloody knife?
His heart, it smokes. It came in from the heart of... Oh, she's dead.
Who dead? Speak, man!
Your lady, sir. Your lady and her sister by Harris poison. She hath confessed it.
I was contracted to them both.
All three now marry in an instant.
Produce their bodies, be they alive to death. This judgment of the heavens that makes us tremble touches us not with pity.
Here comes Kent.
Lord, sir, are you come? The time will not allow the conflict which very manner urges.
Sir, I have come to bid my king and master our good night. Is he not here?
I pay for life. Some good I mean to do in spite of my own nature. Quickly send, be brief in it to the castle, for my rent is on the life of Lear and Cordelia. May send in time.
Run, so hold out now, and send the token directly.
Well thought on. Take thy sword, give it the captain. Hasty, for thy life. She hath commission from thy wife and me to hang Cordelia in the prison, and lay the blame on her own despair that she forbid herself.
Oh, the gods defend her.
Bear him from hence a while.
Oh, you are men of stones. And I have tongues and eyes that use them so that heaven's vault should be cracked. She's gone forever. I know when one is dead and when one lives, she's dead as earth. Lend me a looking glass. That her breath should mist and stain the stone, why then she lives.
Is this the promised end?
On the image of that horror.
Fall and cease.
His feathers stir, she lives. If be so, it is a chance that does redeem all other sorrows ever have I felt.
Oh, my good master!
Is it dull sight? Are you not Kent?
The same, my lord. Your servant Kent, where is your servant Pius?
He's a good man. I can tell you that he'll strike him quickly, too.
No, my lord, I'm the very same man.
I'll see that straight up.
From your first indifference and decay, I have followed your sad steps.
You're welcome, Heather.
Nor no man else. All's cheerless, dark, and deadly. Your eldest daughters have foredone themselves.
I now see that.
Presently are dead.
Dead.
Oh. That's what a trifle here.
You lords and noble friends know our intent. What justice to this great decay may come shall be above. Whilst we will resign, during the life of this old majesty, to him our absolute power.
And my poor fool's hang. No, life. Why should a dog or horse or rat have life and have no breath at all? I'll come no more, never. Pray you, sir, undo this button. Thank you. Sir, look there, look on her lips. Look there!
He fakes! Alive!
No! Fakes not his ghost. Let him pass. He hates him much that would upon the rack of this cruel world. Come and bring him out in a moment.
Bear from hence. Our present business is general woe. Friends of my soul, you twain rule in this realm, and this good state sustain.
I have a journey, sir. Shortly to go. My master calls me. I must not say no.
The weight of this sad time we must obey. It's deep what we feel, not what we ought to say.
The oldest among us, one most, we very young, shall ever see so much, nor live as long.
Thank you. How do y'all niggas feel?
Holy shit. Oh my god. That was good job.
Oh my god. God, we killed it. Stopped it. Fucking stopped it. Yeah, bitch. Woo!
And Mark, you'll be seven.
Yeah, wait, was that really $7? Chicken nuggets and fries.
Hey, Eva, where's
the
bag?
The whole thing was $15. It was $15.87. And I was like,
hell no, it's $3. Come on.